Hello, awesome people. I hope you're having a great day today. Today, we're taking a look at William H. Keefe's novel in the Battletech series, Decision at Thunder Rift, which is this book right now. It's 320 pages long. I was going to knock out 80 pages a day, which is, and I'm reading about 20 pages a half an hour, so about 40 pages an hour, so that would be 2 hours a day. And then knock it out in 4 days. So I knocked it out on 80 days on my first day. I did 160 pages next day because I was traveling from Catonsville to Frostburg on a shuttle to interview for a job at Frostburg State. And then I knocked out, you know, a bunch on that shuttle on the way there. It's about 3 hours trip. And then I knocked out about an hour in the thing. And then I knocked out 80 pages while I was waiting before my interview, and then afterwards while I was waiting for the shuttle. And then I knocked out 120 pages for the sequel on the way back, on that 3 hours on the way back. And then I knocked out my normal 40 minutes in the sequel, Mercenary Star. We're taking a look too. Now, I have been going back and occasionally reviewing things that I read when I was a kid, and I started reading this series in BattleTech novels in 10th grade in high school. I started to play BattleTech in 9th grade, and I started reading the novels that have been published so far. And these novels were published early on in the genre, and are key novels in the storyline. And the first story, Decision at Thunder's Rift, is a story of the founding of the Great Death Legion, which has not existed up until that point and will become a famous mercenary unit. And then the second novel, Mercenary Star, which is going to be about the first mission of this brand new mercenary unit that just got hired at the Mercenary Star, which is where it gets its name from. So, Decision at Thunder Rift is in the military science fiction, since it's a novelization of a war game set in the future in the 31st century. It does have a lot of mechs and so forth in that sort of a battle. It also has other sorts of battles in it too, and it will take chapters to tell single battles. So it's very, very detailed. It's in the military science fiction genre, and military science fiction is my favorite subgenre of science fiction. I've read more than 100 novels. In fact, this series has more than 100 novels. Now, I read each of these novels when they came out when I was in high school. I also went back and read a bunch of older novels, two that had already been published when I started to pick them up and started to read them. And then I went ahead and also continued reading them in college. But since then, I was reading fantasy at the time with the occasional science fiction thing here and there. In serious genres, like I read the Timothys on Star Wars stuff and so forth, but I was really mainly reading some fantasy during high school. And in college, I started to read H.P. Lovecraft and move more into a war genre, which is why I review those three genres for this channel. And I've been reading a lot more horror since college. So that's sort of my move through my genres. So I've gone back and reread a lot of things that I've read only once when I was in junior high or high school or college for this channel that reviews older books and says, okay, so what do I think now? You know, for example, I just read the Dark Sword trilogy of Margaret Weiss and Tracy Hickman, which when I was in junior high, and I knocked out right as soon as I read the Dragonlance six book series that they did, and I went back and reread it now for the first time since junior high and gave you my thoughts, right? And the BattleTech is a large series of more than 100 novels, right? So what do I think of some of the first books that were published in this thing by William H. Keefe Jr., Decision at Thunder Rift? So I think there's value in going back and doing those sorts of things, you know, and some things like the Lords of Dust series by Hugo Award winner, set in his fantasy world, Lawrence Watt Evans, or, you know, going back to the Complete Book of Swords by Fred Saberhagen, which I read when I was in junior high and in grade school in sixth grade. And so I definitely have gone back and reviewed a lot of these sorts of things. And then I went back and read more things in this series that I didn't read previously. So, you know, I've been here and there. And again, since I do reviews of older things, you know, the name of my channel comes from this famous quote, the worst thing about new books is that they keep us from reading old books. And so that idea, that quote from by a French person, is where this iconic idea comes from. So I'm going back and rereading things that were published, you know, in the 80s or the 90s, like the BattleTech series and many of its novels during its key thing. I think it's definitely an important part of this channel. You know, decades ago, it's fine. Right, and also coming back with a fresh perspective, right? What do I think about these things coming back to them as an adult? So we're going to be moving now to the BattleTech series, and we're going to knock out the first Greyhawk, Grey Death Legion rather, trilogy that I'm going back and rereading by William H. Key for the first time, and then after that, I've pulled more things, but I'm very organic with my reading. So it's possible I might knock out, you know, like 8 or 10 books, like I did with going back and rereading Dragonlance for the first time, like the Legend of Huma stuff. But for this channel, although it's possible I might not, right? So I want to be organic and open to that. So maybe I won't really still be in the mood after knocking out this trilogy. But everything in the BattleTech world I've only read once when it was published. And then actually about 10 or 15 years ago, I bought a few novels, but never actually wound up reading them. So that's also too. So Decision at Thunder Ref is a military science fiction short story. It's set on the planet Trellwyn, set on the periphery of the Lyran Commonwealth, which is one of the 5 successor states. It's being attacked and ambushed, and the military unit there is, and then we have basically our main character, Grayson Death, is the lone survivor of this ambush, and he is the son of one of these, you know, battle mechs pilots that runs the unit. That's named after his father, Carlisle's Commandos, and so our main person, Grayson Death Carlisle, is one of our key figures, and he'll be the one who founds this unit in the epilogue of this thing, and so forth. So basically, he's the only person on a world that doesn't like outsiders and is being attacked by outsiders. So you can definitely see how he's an outcast, right? And so building up himself, building up his unit over time, surviving, right, and so forth, and building up his strength and his forces is definitely a key part of what's happening in this novel. So that's what's happening. And again, most of these novels are going to be mech novels, battles rather, are going to be mech battles. But there's going to be, you know, infantry battles that are going to be detailed, particularly infantry on mech battles. There are hovercrafts are pretty common in this book, and there's a lot of hovercraft battles or parts of battle that are a key part of this in addition to infantry. And then there's also some aerospace stuff that's happening too. So a lot of it. So for example, you might end a chapter with a surprise attack that's just been attacked. In the next chapter, we're going to move for the first part to follow another character, and then maybe halfway through that chapter, we'll come back to the surprise. Right. And so William Keith Jr. has a lot of these things, and I found this going back and rereading this. I found this to be pretty gripping. I mean, I knocked out a 320-page novel for a second time, and 3 days, right? I mean, that's pretty good. I've knocked out 160 pages in one day for the sequel. Now, again, I had the benefit of traveling on a bus for, you know, that was shuttling from Baltimore to Frostburg and then back again for 3 hours in 2 back-to-back days while I went and interviewed for a job. I mean, again, you can kind of see what's going on, right, with this sort of process. And so we'll be going back to this. I keep my reviews spoiler-free. So even though this book was published like a long time ago, right, again, this is my spoiler-free review. So I'm giving this, it was gripping. It has a lot of great combat. I think that William H. Keith, he's one of the first writers for the BattleTech universe, puts it on the map. And his battle scenes are very good. And there's a lot of it here. So if you really like combat scenes in your military science fiction, unlike Starship Troopers, which is a key military science fiction novel, doesn't have a whole lot of combat scenes. It's just got more about military, pro-military stuff. Then this is definitely going to be your lobster. And William H. Keith does a good job of building up to that. There is some internal intersphere politics. You'll learn a lot about this universe if you've not read it before, never heard of it before. But the key sort of concept is that it's set in the 31st century. Humans are exploring the universe and have set up thousands of colonies on thousands of planets throughout the world. over centuries. They've never encountered aliens that are intelligent like themselves, so they own it. They have brought their own issues with them, and so there's still military conflicts and so forth. There was about a 300-year peace called the Star League, which united all these various factions, and it was a time of peace and growth and development. And that ended hundreds of years ago, and ever since then, we've been in what have been called the succession wars, as the five successor houses have vied for control against each other. There are also periphery powers, bandit kingdoms, right, and so forth, on the outskirts. And those are going to be major players, the periphery, because this is on the periphery, and a nearby bandit kingdom is going to be a key player in what's happening in this story, as well as the overall arcing war. So that's kind of the basic concept that if you've never heard of it before, which I really like a lot. I like that there's no major sort of things, right? All of the aspects of this world feel realistic. They're not super overdone. Like, you have tanks that are fighting. They look like tanks, right? You've got battle mechs that are fighting, but this is hundreds of years into like 1,000 years into the future. So a battle mech fighting makes a lot of sense, right? It's not, 5 years in the future us defending ourselves from a monster attack, right, or something like that, which would, I don't see how we would turn current technology to that. So it makes sense. This is also one of the key American-created mech genres and IPs, and it's got novels, it's got war games, it's got a role-playing game called Mech Warrior, it's got video games that you might have heard of or played, like the Mech Warrior in the 90s, or the current BattleTech game for the PC that are out there that are doing a lot of fun things. So that's all that universe too. So there you are. I'll go ahead and leave you to it. Have you read Decision of Thunder Rift? If you want to talk about it further in the comments below, I'm giving it a 7. Yeah, probably a 7+. It was gripping. It had a lot of fun stuff. I also liked that it was only 320 pages long, so you can knock it out much more quickly than the 400 pages of the sequel. It's got sequelitis. So I like it. I'm probably going to be giving it a 7+, like a 7.2 or 7.3, rounding it down to a 7. There's a lot of fun stuff that's happening with this. There's a reason why these early novels sold an entire series, right? Stuff just like the Margaret Wise stuff sold an entire genre of novels, right? That were in the Dragonlance novels series. So again, there's a lot of reason why. I definitely remember them fondly. I remember a lot of stuff from this novel when I went back and just knocked it out. So it's a lot of fun stuff that's happening. So that's Decision of Thunder Rift by William H. Keith Jr. If you enjoyed this review, hey, why not hit that subscribe button? There's going to be a lot more of these to follow. And then finally, I want to thank you so much for taking some time out of your day and investing and watching my video. We all have so many things that are happening in our lives, and we're pulled in so many different directions. So the fact that you spend this time with me is incredibly humbling, and I appreciate it. So thanks again, and have an amazing day.